country would win the World Cup by the end of the century. And everyone laughed. 30 years on, and the century drawing to a close, believe me, no one is laughing anymore. Would you like to rock and roll, baby? Would you like to jam with me, mommy? Come on, funky with me, baby. Would you like to move with me, mommy? These scratchy pictures are all that survive of the first African Championships in 1957. Only three teams took part in Khartoum, and it was Egypt who won the title.
That's a good one.
But if you're a World Cup fan, you'll know that African football has come a long way since then.
How about that?
Laying it back, good support from Khalifa, and here comes Kyrie! It's two!
Well, here's a free kick for Cameroon. Up goes.
There it is! It's in there! They scored! Cameroon!
This is where the carnival begins, at the Unity Stadium in Dakar. It's where all the Group A and B matches are going to be played. Three of the favourites play in these groups. The host, Senegal, the past winners Nigeria and Cameroon. And it's the top two in each group that go through to the quarterfinals.
This is an absolutely fantastic stadium by anyone's standards. I think the capacity is about 60,000, and when it's full to capacity, it must be electrifying out here. They've watered the pitch and, you know, the playing conditions are perfect. I wish I was playing.
I only want a hot dog. It's hungry work being a TV presenter, but there's no shortage of choice here in the stadium's food hall. People back home rave about the beef and onion pies at Ayrton Park, but how about this for a halftime snack?
That's Dakar belly.
Morocco press forward, but they're offside here. No, the referee has waved play on. Boulal has rugby available, and that surely is the winner. Zaire will be furious about that. Mukanya. Oh, they're offside on the far post. Kanya scored, and the goal stands. It's 1-1. Siasia. Adepoju now, good run by him. Has Yakini available. 1-0 Nigeria. 7 minutes in, they have the lead. Alaho. A bit of space for the cross now. Yakini's available. Oh, whiplash reflexes by Yakini. And it's 2-0 to Nigeria. What an outstanding piece of skill by Yakini to chest the ball down and score in one movement. Zugu comes across to cover. He's caught a dongo, and a penalty right to the death for Kenya now. They have a chance of a consolation goal by Veche and a chance to make it 2-1, and they've scored. Zaire pressing here. Alenga. Good save, Bell. Chuba. Zaire ahead inside 2 minutes. Mercedes cross. Koundé with a header. Omambik. That's the equaliser. 1-1.
Honours even then. Cameroon and Zambia go through and the Moroccans go out.
This is downtown Dakar. They call it the crossroads of the continent because here is where black Africa meets Muslim Africa. The old meets the new. It's a pretty crazy place, especially today, because host Senegal meet Kenya in a game they must win. Otherwise, they could go out at the first hurdle.
Candy flicks on for Senegal. Senny arriving, and he's got there, 1-0. Sissé with a header. Yes, Bakandi makes it 2. Yum with that long cross. Diagne arriving, and scores. 3-0, Senegal are through.
No surprises then in Group A. Nigeria and Senegal through, and Kenya are on the plane home. The other half of the competition is in Ziguinchor, in the heart of Senegal's rebel country.
This is Moses, our driver. Some people call him Eddie Murphy. Look, we've been driving such a long time now. I mean, how far is it from Dakar to Ziguinchor?
From Dakar to Ziguinchor, if you go via Senegal now, it will be about 600 kilometers.
This is exactly how I started out as a youngster, you know. I was out here playing in these sort of conditions and, you know, you don't have any footwear and you often lose toenails and stuff. So, I mean, sort of going to be watching the African Nations Cup, and to believe that the players that we're going to be watching came from this sort of humble beginnings is going to be absolutely unbelievable. Ziguinchor is going to be very new to us. I mean, what's it going to be like?
Well, Ziguinchor is one of the biggest towns in this region. I mean, the whole Casamance. Casamance is South Senegal. So it's the capital of South Senegal. It's very urban and the people are very nice. The stadium is quite a new one and this is the first time to have football in it. And the people are just looking forward to all the visitors coming in. It's a wonderful place and I'm sure you will like it.
This is Ziguinchor, where all the matches in Group C and D are being played before moving on to Dakar for the final stages. The teams have been very strong and the games have been very tough.
These groups include much-fancied Ghana and the reigning champions Algeria, who begin the defence of their title against the outsiders from the Ivory Coast.
So here's Ben Salah for the Ivory Coast. That kept the ball in play, looking for Traore. Didn't hit it cleanly, but he didn't have to. Akau with this long throw. Ben Halima climbs to the ball. Fofana, 2-0. Algeria have had all sorts of problems during this match. Reduced to 10 men after Adjass was sent off. Here's T now inside the final minute. And Algeria's woe is complete. 3-0 to the Ivory Coast.
This is where you stand when you haven't got a ticket.
So we still await the first goal of this game. Nabalasia flicks it on. Bawala. Yes! Zambia ahead after an hour of the game.
The Group C game between Congo and the Ivory Coast ended goalless. But watch out here for Ghana's Abedi Pele.
Yeboah's after this one. Tshabalala happy to head the ball on the edge of his box, only as far as Pele. Ibrahim. Pele again. Oh, we've waited a long time for a piece of skill like that. And Pele provides it.
In the final Group C match, the holders Algeria have got to beat Congo's Red Devils to stay in the competition.
What's the score going to be tonight? Can we have a prediction? No English?
No, but you're going to win tonight. Okay, there you have it from the Tongians.
Sumu can get great length with these throws. Nagepi flicks on. Chirota! Oh, he hit the crossbar in the previous game. Now he's scored. A minute from half time. Is Saib, he's got round the back. And an equaliser for Bouiche. Is it enough to keep Algeria in the African Nations Cup?
But a draw isn't enough. The champions are out. Congo and the Ivory Coast through from Group C. Half-time in England and the queues are for Bovril and Mars bars. Here it's almost as bad. A circumcision ceremony. Concrete steps aren't my favourite form of seating, no matter how exotic the surroundings. So I traded my stadium tickets, it's £2 for two games out here, and went looking for a touch of luxury. My search took me into the back alleys of Ziguinchor, where I found a much comfier seat and settled down to watch the game on one of the few TVs in the whole of southern Senegal.
Whenever I'm in Ziguinchor, I always hang out with the lads at the bar. It's better than going to the game, isn't it?
Well, Egypt in the green have had insufficient possession to carry through their good intentions, although here's Yeboah for Ghana. He's found half a yard on Ragab. Now, can he finish? Yes, he can! Right to the death, 1-0 to Ghana.
Ghana looking good in Group D. They go through with Zambia, but the Egyptians are out. So with the group games over, the show moves on to Dakar for the final stages. The major shocks, the elimination of the three Arab nations, Algeria, Egypt and Morocco. But as far as the local papers are concerned, the festival continues.
Well, it's quarterfinals day, and as you can see, it's a cold, frosty morning in Dakar. No, seriously. I'm here standing outside the hotels, which the players are staying at. And really, compared to European Championships and the World Cups, the security is really lax. And that gives us a chance to really get amongst the players and get some interviews. I mean, the whole place is really buzzing. Everyone's excited about the games tonight. And it looks as though it's going to be really good. Let's go see what we can find.
I had a chance to play for this lot. I was born in Nigeria and came to England when I was 10. There's actually only one British-based player in the tournament, and he's a key member of the Nigerian squad.
I hear Swansea asking for you back.
Yeah, it's been a bit difficult for me to get sort of time away from the club, but FIFA regulations are quite sort of strict on the subject. So obviously I feel sorry for Swansea that I have to let them down.
But this must be a very big occasion, so yeah, I mean I can understand that you'd want to stay out here and play.
It's not something you can turn down because it's going to happen again next year. Yeah.
Well,
you just have to sort of go for it whilst it's there.
That's right. I mean, I'm sort of out, even though there's no chance of European Championships for me. So I can understand you sort of wanting to play, but are you going to win? We need a prediction.
Oh, yeah. I think the camp's confident. It's going to be very hard today. I think we're more worried about getting today's match over.
Yeah.
Then we just take the semi-final, Ghana or Congo.
Well, I'm going to be flying the flag for the Nigerians anyway. Cheers.
Yeah, thanks very much.
What do you think the difference are between, you know, like African football and European football, you know, so like international level?
You know, it's quite different in Europe because Europe is more disciplined. It's a job, you know, you have to do. It's
like
you work in the office to earn your living.
Yeah.
But in Africa, is they take it to be pleasure, kind of.
Yeah.
But now the professionals are coming in
the ones in Africa now, yeah, realizing that it's business.
Yeah.
And the level is coming up.
So midway through the first half, still Nigeria 0, Zaire 0. Ilaho looking for Yekini. Sia, Yekini, 1-0 Nigeria. Well, they deserved that goal. Their domination of midfield and urgency of their play suggested that they would score first. And it's Yekini with his third goal of the tournament, which separates the sides. 23 minutes gone, Nigeria 1, Zaire 0.
Roger Miller's here, but this time he's in the commentary box, rather than scoring goals like this.
Miller, good turn. Miller inside the penalty area. He gets off the line. Roger Miller's done it. He's the only swinger in town.
Hi, Rog. How are you doing? Do you fancy the Cameroon's chances to win?
Oh, I don't know.
No?
It's very difficult.
Yeah, it's a very hard championship.
Yeah, very hard.
I think Nigeria and Ghana.
Yes.
It's a very good side.
Yes.
Are you going to be playing yourself this year? Or?
No.
Just you're just doing radio work.
Yes.
So, it's, are you enjoying the games? Are they of the same quality as previous years, or do you think African football is stepping up, getting much higher?
Yes, I think.
I think you do very well in the World Cups. America, maybe.
Thank you.
Do you think an African nation is going to win the World Cup in '84? Yeah.
No. I'm tired.
With another sterling challenge, and the Senegal defence once again on red alert. Mabou's cross, Kanya Biek, Ebongu! 3 minutes from full time, they've scored! The substitute has done the damage, and Cameroon can't quite believe it. He came on for Tapoko, and he scored what surely will be now the winning goal in this African Nations Cup quarter-final. Mabou picked out the head of Oman Biek, fell to Kanya Biek, and then into the path of the substitute Ebongu, who makes it 1-0. They can't quite believe it in the Friendship Stadium, because that goal will surely now signal the exit of the host Senegal from the African Nations Cup.
Africa's arrival on the world soccer map has meant a huge increase in press and TV coverage. Even a few British newspaper men made the trip. The serious ones anyway. And the football magazine, when Saturday comes, ran a special charter trip for 80 British fans.
The football, so far, I mean, I've seen 4 games and 3 goals. It's been more dull than watching, park football.
Chesterfield.
Yeah, Chesterfield.
Not Chesterfield, they're a very good side.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, are there any strange happenings, any weird things happen to you along the way? Any adventures?
Nothing too... I fell down a storm drain, and that's about it.
That's about it, a storm drain.
And you... nothing to do with beer at all, falling down the storm drain.
No. Have you got mugs?
I've had... Yeah.
Tell us more about that.
Well, I was just... coming back yesterday and sort of, I don't know, they saw somebody jumped on front of somebody in front of us, and then I saw, and we got here and I was just putting my friend back because he just wandering past the apartments here.
Yeah.
And I don't know, just some people just jumped on me, tried to take my bag, but
so
I
started did you lose anything?
No, because luckily these people in here came out.
We have a Leeds man here. How are you enjoying the trip?
I've been doing it great, thanks.
Yeah.
What really amazed me was the atmosphere in that first game in Ziguinchor. Yeah. You were there as well, weren't you?
Yeah.
I mean, the Congo fans, who were all apparently Senegalese.
Yeah, amazing.
Oh, wow. I mean, they're just...
A lot of energy.
We were spending more time watching them, perhaps joining in with them, than watching the game.
Well, yesterday some guy tried to sell us a pelican.
You're joking?
For eating.
Yeah. A pelican?
Pelican,
you didn't buy it?
No, I didn't fancy it.
I had pelican stew, is quite nice, really.
Well, I don't know.
In Dakar it is, anyway.
Maybe.
What a difference the day makes. Last night, Senegal team were knocked out in front of a packed house here. Today, there's only a handful of Ivory Coast fans for the game against Zambia. Look at it, the place is absolutely empty.
Of course, in Africa, you create your own atmosphere.
And here come the Ivory Coast again. Cassie, CA, it's taken a deflection and got in. Traoré is going to claim it. We waited 90 minutes for a goal, and now 4 minutes into extra time, the Ivory Coast have the lead. Will it be enough to take them through to the semi-finals to meet Cameroon? Cassie helping the ball on towards CA. In fact, it appeared to strike a defender and wrong foot the goalkeeper Tshibala. The Ivory Coast won, Zambia nil.
Ghana haven't been to the final stages of this competition for 8 years, but they're certainly the most entertaining team here. And of course, they've got the most exciting player, Africa's current footballer of the year, the Marseille winger, Abedi Pelé.
How does this compare to like the French league? I mean, playing on the continent.
Well, it's really different because this African Cup of Nations, and then there's, you know, the matches are not like a league matches that, you know, you always have time to, maybe if you lose a match, you'll have about 5 matches to play so that you can overcome your opponents. But this is very, very short, and then you really need to win some matches. And then,
yeah.
You know, so it's really, really difficult for everyone, and then everyone is concentrating in it, so it's making things really hard, you know.
Yeah. I mean, do you think African football is catching up rapidly with the Europeans?
Oh yeah, that is really true, because if you look at what Cameroon did in the World Cup and then Egypt did in the World Cup, I think things are really working very, very fast for the Africans, especially Black Africans, because you could see that the African Cup of Nations of this year is really tough than the couple of years back, you know.
Yeah.
This year, for example, you could see that there have been a lot of maybe foreign coaches handling the countries, and then there is a lot of tactical work and everything, and then you could see that there are a lot of professionals too who have come. FIFA have allowed each one to come and play for his country, so it's really making the teams really tough. Yeah.
Ghana also have the man they call the world's most valuable player, 18-year-old Nir Odati Lamptey, fast becoming a major star with Anderlecht in the Belgian First Division.
Back in England, in Europe, you know, you're being billed as the next Pelé or the next Maradona, you know, you've got the star billing here. Is that a problem for you?
Well, yeah, a little bit problem with the competition like that, because everybody knows me, you know. So, if you can see against Egyptians, if I have the ball, they try to break my leg.
Yeah, so the market,
you know, is difficult for me, but I would try to do my best. Yeah.
Do you feel a lot of pressure in this competition?
Yeah, not really, but a little bit, but not much.
Yeah, it must be nice to have people like Abdi Pelé and those kind of guys playing alongside you. Does that help you?
Yeah, sometimes, yeah. You know, they give me confidence. Like Tony Yeboah, they give me confidence. We train together, we talk together. You know, they give me a lot of confidence to play. So I don't have problem. I just play my game.
What's that? The manager just gives you a free roll and tells you just to do your own thing?
No, he gave about... Yeah, two of us, I and Abedi, to do our own thing, but, you know, I just give Abedi to go ahead, because if he's doing it and I'm doing it, it's going to be a problem for the team.
Still stalemate, but here's Lamptey. Yeboah, 1-0 Ghana. Half an hour in, and Yeboah breaks the deadlock. Ndomba, always heading for that dead ball line. Chibota's on the back post, and he's equalised! He scored against Algeria, the holders of the African Nations Cup, and now he's done it again against the favourites. The architect of the goal was Ndomba, but watch out for Chibota on the back post, completely unmarked, and with a stooping header, makes it 1-1. Questions must be asked about the Ghanaian defending. Pelé's found half a yard. He's past Mouyabe. He's inside the box. Oh, it's
it's the outstanding goal of the competition so far from Abide Pelé. Otto Pfister's up off the bench. So too are the Ghanaian substitutes, because they hail the man who could take Ghana all the way to the final. This was sensational. Biyabi didn't stand a chance, and neither did Brice Samba in the Congo goal. Look at the swerve on this shot.
It's semi-final time, folks, and Ghana, who have certainly looked the most exciting team so far, have got a tough draw against the Super Eagles from Nigeria. And probably the people's favourites, Cameroon, have drawn the elephants from the Ivory Coast. We've been talking to the men under most pressure, the coaches. I mean, so like back at home, they don't know a lot about the organisation of the competition, but I mean, how have you found, you know, the running of this competition so far?
All of the best African players are here without John Salako.
Thank you.
All of the best are here, and the competition is tough. They play good football, only in the organization there are some points who are not so well. Then I have never seen a tournament where all the teams are together in one hotel.
Yeah,
if you do that in Europe, if you do that in Europe, I don't see England, Germany and Holland in one hotel.
No, that's right, that's right.
Nous connaissons bien le Nigeria parce que nous avons les Blacks de Ghana, ils ont joué pendant la qualification. On a fait match nul 0-0 à Lagos, without professional players, without Pele, without Yeboah, without Ali Ibrahim. The team has won the return match in Kumasi 1-0. Also, we have in the last 2-3 years, we have all matches, we have win or draw with Nigeria. It's not a problem.
You've actually been eating your meals at the embassy. Is there any reason for that, any special reason?
If you are the opponent of the hosted team,
yeah,
then they do something with you, you know. It starts with small things. And the Cameroons did not... First it was this. They take long time for the food. And you know, when Nigerians must wait for food, they are very angry.
Definitely.
Then at home they can say food here, and in 1 or 2 minutes the food is there.
Yeah.
So it takes 1.5 hours, though they don't like that. And then suddenly we stand up and we went out here and eat here. We went to the buffet. And what is this? Take too long time, so we eat here. And then the next time it was Cameroon, was the opponent of Senegal. And they did the same. But the Cameroons did it on another way. They went into the kitchen and broke all the boards.
Oh, no. That's tough.
So we go to the embassy and eat there.
Oh, all is possible in football. We have a chance like all other teams. I think we have a very good team. Cameroon had a very good team. Nigeria also is not so bad. In the semi-final, is a question, is a knockout system. All is possible.
Yeah.
I hope we have a very good chance.
Yeah. But I mean, back at home, I mean, everyone's really taking so much interest in African football now,
yeah.
And there's a lot of coverage as like this program. I mean, how long do you think it is before maybe an African nation wins the World Cup?
Wins the World Cup, it's a big word, but come to the last four and to a final, I think in 8 years they are there.
8 years. By the end of the century, in other words?
I want to be there in the next World Cup, 1994. And if you are not playing more for England, you play for us.
Okay, I'll take up on that.
Aliha. Adeposhu, it's crept in. Adeposhu gives Nigeria the lead after 11 minutes. And where were the tall Ghanaian defenders? Kaisari to take the corner. Here's Pelé. 1-1. Oh, an outrageous goal by Abide Pelé. His third in the competition. Opoku celebrates with the Ghanaian players. But why didn't Nigeria have a man waiting on the right-hand upright? It would have saved them a goal. Ruben Agboola on the left-hand upright. Nobody on the right. Still 1-1. Corner then to Ghana. Abora, Opoku! Ghana have come from behind and now lead Nigeria by 2-1. And are in sight of the African Nations Cup final. Opoku from close range after Abora had turned the ball on.
So, as Coach Pfister confidently predicted, Ghana have made it past Nigeria. But at what cost? The star player of these finals, Abedi Pele, leaves the field in tears. He knows he won't be playing in the finals because he picked up his second booking of the tournament. At the age of 30, he knows he's unlikely to get another chance.
Josh Larkin, Channel 4 England. What does he think the chances are of the Ivory Coast winning the whole competition now?
C'est quoi? Nous avons toujours joué les premiers rôles. Je dis non. Nous avons toujours joué le spectacle et nous retournons chez nous sans la coupe. Et je pense qu'aujourd'hui, les joueurs savent qu'il faut jouer utile, il faut jouer le résultat. Et le beau football, après un match de football, on demande qui a gagné, on ne demande pas qui a bien joué. À l'époque, les joueurs, on a même eu parfois le trophée fair play, etc., etc., mais jamais le trophée lui-même.
Ouais, la Coupe du Monde, c'est il y a 2 ans. Donc 2 ans, c'est énorme dans une carrière de joueur professionnel. C'est le tiers d'une carrière, puisque la moyenne d'une carrière d'un joueur, c'est 6 ans. Donc en 2 ans, il se passe beaucoup de choses. Bon, c'est vrai que le Cameroun a apporté beaucoup au football africain, puisque pour la prochaine Coupe du Monde, il y a un troisième pays qualifié grâce au Cameroun. Mais il y a le revers de la médaille, c'est que toutes les équipes, et c'est bien normal, veulent battre le Cameroun et se donnent à fond dans leur confrontation contre cette équipe.
But Cameroon couldn't break down an unbeaten Ivory Coast defence despite missing a penalty and hitting the post in the first minute. So it's down to a penalty shootout, and as we join it, both sides have taken 2 penalties.
Oh dear, that was an absolutely awful penalty. Oman Biek has the chance to bring Cameroon level here, and he's missed it. Is 3-1. Well, what a twist here. One goalkeeper against another. Bell has to score against his counterpart to keep his team in it. And it was an awful penalty again. And Ivory Coast have done it. Ivory Coast have made the final.
More than 30 teams started this competition over a year ago. Now we're down to the last 2. In just a few hours, the final begins. Ghana versus the Ivory Coast. The prize, the 18th African Nations Cup.
Welcome to this 18th African Nations Cup final. Let's have a look at the Ghanaian team. Defender Appiah, midfield player Ibrahim out, but of course the man they'll miss most of all, the African player of the year, Abedi Pele, who's already scored 3 goals for them in this tournament. Prince Polly, who came on as a substitute and scored the winner against Nigeria, not surprisingly keeps his place. The Ivory Coast team, well, the big news here, still no Fofana, the Monaco player who has been injured since the first game, in fact, of the tournament. But Abdoulou Traoré, who is the record goal scorer in Ivory Coast international history, claims over 60 international goals, is back in the side. The referee today, Badar Sene, is from the host nation. And Dakar, the city which has now hosted 14 of the 20 games, the tournament began back here 2 weeks ago, now stages the final. Ghana in the yellow shirts, attacking from right to left. Ivory Coast forced to change into their second strip of green shirts and white shorts. I'm sorry if you find the numbers a little bit hard to read on the Ghanaian players' jerseys, so do we. Has looked absolutely outstanding and scored some cracking goals, 3 altogether in this competition. A break off as danger threatens again here, and the defender has played a suicide ball back into the middle, and that should have been a goal for Prince Polly. In the opening 5 minutes, Ghana should have gone in front. It was a disastrous decision by the defender, and Prince Polly ought to have punished them. This should have been number 1. Ivory Coast in all sorts of problems there. Oh, it's a heaven-sent opportunity. Big interest here, of course. This final going worldwide on television for the first time in its history. Many European countries seeing these players in action for the first time ever. Kwame Akar. And again, he gets a good distance on them. Very useful weapon that is. And from it, indeed, they might well have scored a goal. I think it was Traore. It was Abdoulaye Traore with the header. Martin.
Well, it's a tactic that almost worked a few times against Cameroon. You mentioned Akar's very, very long throw. Terrific. Tihai got up to get a nice touch on. And Traore, well, most certainly tested Ansa if he didn't actually beat him.
Ball knocked out of play for a throw-in to Ghana. Sam, the tall central defender, getting there just ahead of Yeboah. And here he is again, trying to win the corner off Akar, but doesn't do so. Diaby clears his lines, it comes back in again. But Ivory Coast, so comfortable on the ball, as all these teams have been in these championships. The skill factor, a big thing, and we can see it again here now. That could have been really dangerous because Traore was in a perfect position and had goalkeeper Ansah not made a time the interception, then Ivory Coast might well have found themselves in the lead. Ghana hit back as quickly as they can, and this too looks dangerous for the Ivory Coast players. Asare. The shot blocked from Abora. They've got it back again. Looked like a foul on Asare, not given though. And threaded through by Mensah and a poor ball.
It was a good attack by Ivory Coast. Just felt that perhaps maybe he had to cut it a bit further back. Give really no problem to answer. Ivory Coast already know that they're in a big game, because no sooner had that attack break down that Ghana were on the attack on the other end. And unlike Cameroon in the semi-final, Ivory Coast were able to retreat with no real problem. Here Ghana have thrust forward very, very incisively, and I feel that Ivory Coast will have to guard that, despite the fact that they have to get attacks themselves.
And here they go again, looking dangerous down that left-hand side. And that seems to be the problem area as far as Ghana are concerned. I was saying they'd switched Asare over from the right-back position to the left-back, and maybe they have to think about switching him back again, because there's all kinds of gaps opening on Ghana's right-hand side of the field defensively. But they're now going forward into a good area again, in an attacking sense, but a wasted opening, really, a poor cross. And the Senegalese referee, Badar Sene, will blow the whistle for the start of the second half here. And let's hope we see a little more goal-mouth action than we did in the first half. The football was admirable enough, good skills from both sets of players, but both goalkeepers not really tested often enough for the sake of neutral spectators. And Ghana have won an early free kick here in a dangerous position. Lamte, foul. He's certainly one of those on the field capable of breaking the deadlock here. Manuel Ampere will take the kick to test Alan Guameni. Yeboah, an obvious target here, the tall number nine, and Bafo, the central defender who comes forward for most of these. In fact, he fools everybody by knocking it to his right, and it wasn't a bad effort at all. Well saved. Mensah with the shot, and the goalkeeper did well, really, to readjust here, because I suspect, like most of us, he was expecting the ball to be clipped in for one of the big men on the far post. CA playing it infield. This looks promising, knocking the ball about neatly here, and then Magui gave it away, but they've rather fortunately got it back with Otokore. And he goes round the first challenge well, Otokore, and was surely pushed over, wasn't he, by Ampere. Again, the referee hasn't given it. Play on the decision. Good running then by Yeboah, turned his defender beautifully. Now takes up a position in the middle, hoping for the cross. Well, it looked close. I'm not quite sure it was as close as the crowds ooh and ah seemed to indicate then. And Ghana suddenly break quickly with Lamte and Yeboah looking very lively up front. But sheer weight of numbers overcame them then. Mensah beaten to it, and a good ball played out to that far side, and they've got players again in the middle here, Lehigh and Traore, and that was real danger. The ball striking the bar. Easy for Amar, Manuel Amar, the big defender who was sent off in one of the early games in the tournament against Egypt. In the words of the old cliche, it has been a day when defences have been on top this. Good run by Yeboah, and suddenly danger here, and again it was Polly who couldn't get the ball under control. Lovely little ball to release him by Yeboah, and it may have been a bobble on this awful surface, or it may have been a poor first touch by Polly, but just as quickly as the chance came, it was gone. Magui swings one in to Ghana's penalty area, easily dealt with though by Bafo. Sam's clearance, not a good one. Straight back to Ghana, and Pierre playing it back infield again to Mensah. Mensah opens it up, or tries to anyway, looking for Asari on the left, and Asari's done well here. Good work by Asari, and a useful looking cross as well. This could be it. The substitutes bundle it towards goal and couldn't get it over the line. Nawu and then Lamte, both threatening danger, and Guameini's goal is still intact, astonishingly.
I thought Guameini has done brilliantly again. He's had to come out, he's thrown himself there, he's tried to get the nick, he's hurt himself, but it was an excellent chance for Ghana. Excellent chance. Again, great ball in. It's one of those that it just is not coming down for me. Decides to knock it over the defender's head. Guameini has come out. I thought that he took his life in his hands there, and he's injured, and it'll be a shame if he doesn't get up out of this one.
Well, that was brave goalkeeping by Alan Guameini. He got injured, remember, in the semi-final against Cameroon. Martin, this was terrific play here, wasn't it, on the left-hand side by Asari.
Asari has done incredibly well, incredibly well. It's a great ball in. He knows that there's two or three Ghana players in there. All he has to do is just find an area. The bobble is affected the game more than anything else. But again, I felt Guameini, he's just going down there. I thought he's done brilliantly there.
Well, for the second game in succession, concern amongst the Ivory Coast reporters and commentators, but particular concern on the bench as their goalkeeper requires lengthy treatment. He's all right.
Strange enough, just a moment or two ago, I was going to say to Alan that for the most part, the Ivory Coast haven't had to defend that desperately in situations like that. You know, they've been reasonably comfortable, and Guameini must be very, very proud of the men in front of them. They've done a splendid job, and there suddenly they just lost possession on the right-hand side of the field. It was just a bad ball out, that delayed in possession of the ball, lost it. Asari has made a terrific run in, and it's a great ball in.
And from it, after all the excitement and the treatment to Guameini, Ghana only have a corner. Ampere with the kick then, and another test for Guameini, having just been injured. It's hit in deep, and the shot came through the crowd of players and could easily have been turned in by Mensah on the near post. They had two or three players in a good position then. Polly was another one of them.
It's just a lazily taken corner kick. It's gone in. He's had an excellent shot. It's gone so very, very close.
We've got a minute to go, plus time to be added for stoppages, and there will be a little bit of that for the injury to Guameini, the Ivory Coast goalkeeper. We're still waiting for the crucial first goal of this final. Ivory Coast go forward with CA. He's dispossessed, though, by a fine challenge. A dangerous looking ball out to Yeboah. Oh, he's hit the post and they couldn't quite get the rebound forced in. Well, would you believe it? Lamptey, in fact, the player who hit the shot, and with less than a minute to go, well, the game would surely have been won had that gone in. It was a splendid effort and whacked against the upright, with the goalkeeper apparently beaten.
Well, we may get a chance to see it, but I'll tell you, if for all the credit that we've thrown on Guimene, if he had been beaten, despite the fact it's been hit with such venom, if he had been beaten at the near post, Alan, with a minute to go, I think he would have been desperately annoyed with himself, despite the fact that it was a powerful shot.
Only free kick, which was a poor one initially, was cleared, and the second shot in wasn't a bad effort. There's the shot against the upright.
Was certainly a thunderous shot by Neil Lampton.
Isn't it amazing? You wait all this time. We're now, in fact, into time being added for a first really clear shot at goal from any distance. The other efforts have been rather scrambled efforts in the box. Yeboah going up well and couldn't really turn quickly enough to get behind the shot. As we move into stoppage time, perhaps the intervention of the upright has underlined the fact that we've got two teams here who are going to take a great deal of separating. We might have to go all the way to penalties again, I suspect. Good work though by Traore, and Traore's got round the defender here, and the cross didn't really carry any weight or conviction. Pity that from Ivory Coast point of view.
When you see the Ghanaian effort today, you can see how much of what great importance that Abidi Pelle is to them.
And that is the final whistle. In fact, Martin, we have reached 90 minutes. Ghana 0, Ivory Coast 0. A disappointing final in which there have been so few opportunities, but sensationally, victory could have gone Ghana's way right at the death when Lamptey hit the post with a fine shot.
The match went into extra time, and Ivory Coast had a great chance to win it in the very last minute. Joel T. High through, but he just couldn't finish it off. What an opportunity. So to the penalties. Ghana missed one, so here's another chance for Ivory Coast. And guess who? It's T. High again. This is for the championship. It's agony. Sudden death now, and astonishingly, it goes to 10-all. Even the goalkeepers have scored. Back to the beginning.
Indeed, we have gone right the way back to the beginning, in the sense that Akar will have to take the next kick for the Ivory Coast. We still, of course, have the sudden death aspect of this. We don't get another compulsory five per side. Fister, the coach, unhappy about something. So we're still down to the situation where if one team scores and the other misses, it's all over. Akar for the Ivory Coast. It was a bit lazy and a lot of fortune went into it. Ansar's furious, Akar's relieved. He scored again. It's 11-10 to the Ivory Coast.
Just went through Ansar's hands. Dived the right way, got himself in a decent position. Oh.
So presumably now Bafo, the captain, will come forward again. Yes, there he is, to take this next penalty for Ghana, and must score. Psychologically, one feels that winning the toss to get the first penalty has given the Ivory Coast a big advantage here, because each time they score, of course, the pressure's on Ghana to make sure that they equalise. Bafo's got to score this one. missed it. The Ivory Coast have won the cup. The scenes of celebration are fantastic. And why not? For the first time in their history, the Ivory Coast can call themselves the champions of all Africa. By 11 goals to 10 in the penalty shootout, they have beaten the champion of all champions, Ghana, and history has been made here in Dakar.